or you can just fire questions in between. I mean, the most important slide is the last one, of course, but okay. I've changed the title several times. It's the last version, so I cannot change it anymore. What are you doing? I've not signed for you. The first thing which is important to keep in mind is anything I say is, of course, biased. Some of you know already, some of us do not. So when I speak about the word, I mention the word standard, I really mean it. When I speak about open access, I do mean it. You will see I present the INRIA thing there. And now I've got this heavy burden on my shoulders, being the president of the board of directors of the Dariah infrastructure, where open scholarship is one of the core missions. I'm going to make two little windows based on the concept. I've added Tara for you, Alex. First, to present a few issues related to open access to publications. I guess this is probably the best known area for most of you, and then speak about issues related to open scholarship concerning research data, research sources, and the like. It's more a series of thoughts, because I've picked up a few keywords when preparing this this presentation, and thought about the best slides I had to illustrate the corresponding keywords. So it's more like a patchwork presentation. Did I want to say something? Yeah, the important thing is the last line in this slide, which is the psychological aspect. We keep fighting against the big publishers because they are evil, as we know, and those kind of things, but we are all evil somewhere. Each time we've got some reluctance to put something online because we think something wrong may happen, because our professor would not accept that, because a publisher would not like it, and because with whom did I discuss recently concerning putting one's PhD online at the time of defense, for instance. There are a few things where we are responsible for not being open somehow. So this open attitude you mentioned is essential here. So we need to understand those processes and give ourselves, so this presentation is more like to give ourselves the good arguments for doing things right, rather than trying to convince the others. I mean, I still have to be convinced at times. So publication, the French. We started with the first journal. Do not believe the people who said that it was the philosophical transactions of the Royal Society of London. There was this Journal des Savants before them, okay? So it's very important. So, it's not open history, it's the history of openness, but you need to keep this in mind. We were the first. Yeah, okay, the Brits have introduced the concept of peer review, which, when you think about it, was not necessarily the best invention you could have, because they could have thought of social networks and things like this, but they never thought of it. So that was the history. The important point is that 1665, if you compare it with Egyptology, was, if you compare with anything related to human culture, is a very short amount of time, especially because most of the journals have been created in the 20th century. So it's a small amount of time. But during this amount of time, we had a couple of problems already. So you've all seen something resembling this diagram. This nice line here is the expenditures of university libraries and the like on journal subscriptions. This line is to compare with the following slide, which is this one. That's the profits by Elsevier since 2002. Just go around and look at the number of industries which are actually having 33% revenue. I think it's after taxes, if I'm not wrong. Go to the car industry, go to the radio industry, go to any kind. In the information industry, scientific publication is the most profitable domain. Any, okay? So if you want to buy some shares and do some money, you should go there. Unless you believe what I'm saying is valuable, because then you know there is a danger to buy shares. The other important factors in there, just for the background, is it's an interesting thing. It's like you would go to a garage, you would have to to build your car yourself, you know, do everything basically, and you would pay the garage to have your cars ready. So we're writing the papers, we're doing the peer review for free, and we're reading. It's a very valuable industry because the consumers, which are addict consumers, as we all are, as scholars, are doing the job, more or less. And you've seen on the left-hand side that I speak about publishers and learned societies. I don't know in your domains, but in, I'm a computer scientist. IEEE is doing an awful job in this domain. It's even worse than publishers like Springer and Elsevier in the price policy they have, in the kind of services they give. So we need to be aware that there's a global problem with the system there. So that's the context. It's really a shortcut. Why, basically, since 15, 20, you can go back to 25, 30 years, there's been such a movement towards open access in the libraries and in the research communities. I'm really mentioning the two because sometimes they've gone in parallel, not always speaking to one another. You may agree with that. And there is also a necessity to have a global view on that. My reference point is always the Berlin Declaration concerning open access, because this is the time where, I would say, as opposed to individuals evangelizing concerning open access or fighting for open access, the Berlin Declaration is something which has been signed by a huge number of institutions, universities, research institutions and the like. And basically, I guess in 20 years, we'll still have the same quote on the same slide, basically, because all the keywords are there. The fact that access to information should be free, irrevocable, you cannot say, well, sorry, you cannot use that anymore, worldwide, and the keywords to use, of course, to be able to read it online, to distribute, transmit, and display in any form and any kind of derivative work. That's very essential. So if you've got things like in the Creative Commons domain, share alike, or non-derivatives, no derivatives, you're basically against the Berlin Declaration. You're not really open access because you prevent usage. You pretend you put something online, but you prevent further reuse of the content. In the publication domain, there are usually a couple of colors there, maybe more. Just to give you a, I mean, everyone knows about green and gold, yeah?
Sorry, not to interrupt, but just I'm curious about that point on derivation and distribution, because the line that I always am interested in with the Berlin Declaration is to say, for any responsible purpose. And how do you help yourself without being able to enforce your rights?
Yeah, that's exactly the discussion I had per SMS with my kid this morning, wanted to know what I was about to talk about this afternoon. This notion of responsibility. As soon as you put something online, I'm really speaking as a scholar, and you address this material to other scholars, you've got responsibilities on both sides. You're speaking of plagiarism, typically.
Yeah.
Plagiarism, this cannot exist in the open access world. As soon as you put something online, I mean, you know, metaphorically, let me take, you think it has nothing to do, but it has. Peer reviewing, anonymous peer reviewing. I take the first paragraph from a paper without knowing the author, put that on Google, most of the time I find a similar paper by the same author because the vocabulary is the same and the like. So plagiarism is exactly the same thing. If you put your paper in open access, anyone can plagiarize, who cares? Because you can even say, look, they've cited me without citing me. So you can be proud of it in a way. And the guy as a scholar will put his fame, responsibility, what have you, on the plate there. So this vocabulary, green open access, gold open access, is important to situate things, but it's not the ultimate analysis that you should have in the problem. So green open access means, as an author, I'm responsible for putting the material online. Whatever I've done concerning peer reviewing, publication in a journal, what have you, I'm publishing, I really use this word on purpose, I'm publishing my own paper on a publication repository, for instance. It's publishing. Remember, you don't, I mean, in any kind of dictionary, when you look at publishing, you don't have peer reviewing. It's two different concepts. You need to remember that. You don't need peer review to publish. And gold open access means, I mean, the person I've charged with the duty of publishing my content is putting the thing online. So usually a publisher is responsible for gold open access. So in gold open access, you may have spontaneous gold open access, a nice publisher just putting that online, or the publisher can ask you, well, if you pay a fee, I will put your paper online. That's the case of anything which is related with the notion of article processing charges. That is, the charges you've got to pay to get your paper freely accessible online. If I'm going too quickly, I want to get to the discussion there. Just to mention that, for those who want to do a little bit of open access policy, gold open access for us, I'm coming from a research performing organization, not a university, that's very expensive because we consume far less than we produce in terms of research, as opposed to university, where a lot of students consume the research papers and produce less in comparison. So we're not fans of gold open access. So that's one of the reasons. That's one of the reasons why we issued this policy in January last year. So it's a little bit more than one and a half years we've issued this policy, where we said, well, first, concerning green open access, it's just mandatory. If you want your paper to appear in an annual report of some sort for your team, for your personal records, to get any kind of upgrade in your position, the paper has to be online, full stop, no discussion. If you don't want to be seen, you're not obliged to put your paper, but it will not be in the report. And we explore new models. So when I spoke about gold being a little bit cautious that it would just be publishers, we see how, for instance, putting a paper online as a preprint, as a draft, would allow you to create a peer reviewing environment on top of it. You put a paper online, you just push that to an editorial committee and say, please stamp my paper as valuable for your journal. It's called post-publication peer review, or overlay journal in this case. This is the kind of things we are exploring. Concerning gold open access, basically we say anything which has to do with an extra fee that you would have to pay on top of the normal subscription scheme, we don't want that. We don't pay for that. So what is called hybrid open access. By Springer, it's called open choice, and you've got similar schemes by various publishers. So we just forbid our researchers to pay anything like that. If they want their paper in open access, okay, they publish that in a Springer journal and put the paper in the publication repository. Two different things. I just mentioned, it was to Walter, there is a word missing, which is embargo. We don't know what an embargo is. Does not exist in the researcher's world. It's an invention by publisher. If you abide to embargo, and Voltaire will elaborate on that, you're just already taken by the shark there. And the second thing is that, of course, you've got some native open access journals. If you think of the Biomed Central portfolio, for instance, and a few others, these are journals where you never pay any subscription to get them, but you've got to pay each time you publish, so you've got to pay article processing charges each time you publish a paper there. So it's not a double payment, so we accept that, but we've got a central budget to make sure we control what we're doing. Because this is one of the dangers of gold open access. Instead of having central, even national negotiations with publishers where you would have a global view about how much you pay to the publishers here, you can imagine each researcher on his DFG INR grant to actually pay a little thing to have his paper published. And you lose track of what's going on and how much money is going to the publishers anymore. That's bad. So that's the global pictures concerning publication, with this very strong INRIA policy. If we had this policy everywhere in Europe, I think we would have a good point already. I'm not sure there is a mandate in Trinity, Alex. Dariah is not mandatory. But still, you need to imagine that there is a huge gap, in any case, to fill with regards to the general culture, the open culture of the researchers. So to finish up on publication very quickly, I wanted you to read this. This is a real citation. I've not invented that in the train. It was on the PDF, file of a PhD dissertation online. If you don't want to read that, it says, it's online, but please don't use it. I mean, don't even think about taking anything from it. Can you imagine that? If you Google, you will discover that someone from the TI community, and that's really annoying, but never mind, no names. XX. So that's exactly the open attitude. You put something online, but you make sure you ask even a lawyer for the appropriate copyright statement you should put in there. No, never ask a lawyer, okay? Never in your life. You've done that yesterday, last week. You've asked a lawyer already. You could dream of it, yeah. You'd get that. I mean, it's, I can mention names because she changed her mind. You all know Anne Bayot from Berlin. I mean, working on the husband of one of her Mitarbeiter is a lawyer. So the before doing anything, they ask him what they should put on the website concerning the reuse of material. And they got a two-page like this in German concerning possible reuse. Now it's all CC BY, so it's nice, but you always think, you need to think about that. It means that if you're convinced what I'm saying now and you're going to speak to others, you need to say, well, let us be cautious on how far I can go with this person, with this project, with this environment, because the culture may not be there as to the advantages concerning this. Somehow, it's even worse or sometimes easier with data. So I'm taking Anne, but she never did that. It was just because she was in the room when I did this slide. So, it's the problem with sharing data in open access is a little bit different because sometimes you're willing to do it, but you just do it plain wrong. So the best examples is when you've got a nice data from your DFG project and you think, oh, it would be nice to put a very nice HTML web page, and you do all those things, you spend hours choosing the colors, the fonts and everything to put this nicely online. And you think, well, it's very nice. You can show that to your colleagues and you've done it right because it's open. Usually you start doing that and then at the final, you don't open that. I mean, you keep it with a firewall because it's not completely ready, and 6 months afterwards you think you would change something, your data is not perfect. Why can this be plain wrong? First, I mean, putting something in HTML is the most important thing. The most important thing is really authorship. You need not put your material, but put your research results. It's a completely different attitude, if you see what I mean. Just to take the example of this Zantman manuscript on which Anne Bayot worked, if you put the Zantman manuscript online, it's not the manuscript you put online. It's the scientific, the scholarship you have that you apply to this manuscript to actually provide the best transcription and analysis and then put it online. So authorship is really important. And this is a way also to open the scholarly dialogue with others who would actually provide comment to you. So make a big difference between the notion, the abstract notion of data and the notion of scholarly result that you have when you create some data, analyze some data and the like. The second aspect, of course, the format standards. Putting something in HTML, it can be read but not reused. What would you do with such a file? You've got a nice thing in italics, but you don't know if it is a proper name, the name of a work of someone, and you need to have something in the background, text encoding initiative, that could provide more semantics behind the scene, for instance. technical sustainability, it's not for today. I mean, it's really something important, but putting that on a platform which is proprietary, which is probably private, is not as good as finding a good and stable infrastructure where you could have a guarantee that your data will still be available after a while. And of course, so complementary to authorship is the notion of reuse instructions. So there are two ways to do it wrong. I mean, this one, you know already. All rights reserved, please do not use. And the other one is not to say anything. So if you don't say explicitly, please do reuse under the condition that you quote my work, you're losing something there. You're losing this connection in the scholarly dialogue, which is essential. Okay. So now that's a few questions of the audience. Given this little example and this very biased analysis I'm making on this example, we can take some distance with that and ask ourselves, is it wise to openly share humanities data? That's a question that was asked to me when I attended a panel in Dublin last year. Were you there, Alex? This panel on open access organized by Sandra Collins. And asking in principle this question, is it wise to openly share humanities data, reveals the kind of fears that one may have. If I put this online, someone may steal my data. But it's exactly what you want. I mean, you want to be stolen. You want to be reused, basically. So this is something that you need to turn into your head. If you've got a nice scholarly edition, you've got a nice set of data, you in the archaeological domain or data you got from archives, if you see that as a research result, not as data, you're not frightened anymore. If it is data, the other one will use the data before I've started to do so. It's my data. No, your results, your analysis is important to put online. So you should not be afraid, for instance, that another researcher is doing the same research as you. I know of no equivalent breed. Even among twins, they would not think the same. So it's important to have a community, for instance, of people working on the same data, because then you can exchange and so on, and be quoted for what you've done. The other thing is this commercial thing. If I put my transcription of this manuscript online, you'll have a Chinese publisher publish that, you know, as a book, what have you. WTF means who cares, I think, in English. Something like this. It's not our job. It's not a problem. It has existed before the digital era was there. You know, you had in the 17th and 18th century, there are wonderful stories about books being just plagiarized all over the place and being transferred from France to Italy. I've seen a presentation on that, on horses, you know, up copies of the book sold to the Italians. It's really not an issue. It's something, it exists. It's part of the human nature. Nothing has changed. Otherwise, we will be in a wonderful place where we would all be smiling all the time. There are some difficulties there, but from a scholarly point of view, it should not prevent you from just disseminating. So the real question is it wise not to openly share humanities data? We usually can quote dance, but I never managed to. So basically, anytime it is possible, share your data. There are times when it is not possible, when you've gathered data about persons, typically psychological experiments where you do interviews with people. The nice example is about endangered languages, where there were some agreements between the DOPES project, Dokumentationsbedrohte Sprachen, and small communities in Amazonia, where, I mean, the knowledge of certain songs correspond of the fact that you belong to the community, so you cannot just put that online so that anyone would know. It's really a secret to know some songs. So this is not publicly available. It's only you need to ask for a specific agreement to access that. But unless you've got those kind of very good reasons, I don't know. I mean, it's like fighting against your own interest to be left unknown. One of the questions that were asked there is what kind of benefits, so it's more the positive way of seeing things. What are the, what kind of benefits accrue, I didn't know that verb before, from open access to humanities data for researchers and for citizens? It's obvious. I mean, the fact that, just consider the medieval domain, transcribing a medieval manuscript takes so much time that you need the others who have transcribed other manuscripts to make sense, to build up a corpus. So you need to share that to pool results. You need to be able to compare and check the results. The humanities, that's like any kind of other sciences. In my language, we just have one word, science, for all this. You need to be evidence-based. If you tell that in the medieval age, this person went at this period from this place to this other and met this other person, you need to be able to point to the exact data which proves that, not just fancy something in a scholarly paper. The important thing, which is to the public, is showing that hard work is being done. There is this usual fantasy that humanities is worth nothing, and they just read a couple of books, write a couple of papers, and manage to get there until they're retired, and nothing good comes out of it. It's very important to show that the humanities do some sensible work, and a lot of the work done, in particular in cultural heritage at large, has some impact on the society. So putting results online brings something. Third question and then conclusion. The third question was, what sort of use and reuse is made of shared humanities data? I think I've tackled that already. The most important point is like the second one. We need to have trust in scholarly principles. If we are decent scholar and we think we are mainstream in the sense of being honest, we should think that the others are basically mainstream and honest as well. So this is why I like so much this CC BY license in Creative Commons, because it says, do whatever you want with my stuff under the condition you mention I was at the source for this stuff. And that's all we need, basically. The rest is unessential. So, I wish we were on the lundi de Pentecôte, because you would just receive the Holy Spirit. What are you going to do once you've received the Holy Spirit? The most important thing is the first line. Accept that being a scholar is being a public person. So, you shouldn't hide yourself. You shouldn't be afraid of plagiarism. You shouldn't be afraid of your own self-plagiarism. That is, it's normal to tweet an idea, to make a little blog post from your idea, put a paper for a workshop or a conference, and at the end of the day think, oh, I could make a nice journal paper. And if ideas goes on, you make a book out of that. What have you? I don't care. Maybe not a book, it's so old-fashioned. But it's something useful. Put all your papers in the publication repository. If you discover now, with your conscience, that you still have papers which are not freely available online, not readable by your interested readers, you spend the whole morning, tomorrow morning, no, before you come to the session, before the breakfast, you put all your papers online in your publication repository. You've got no reason not to do so. If you're really tough, mutig, sagt man auf Deutsch, you could do that even before peer reviewing. That's the next stage, but maybe I'm asking too much. I mean, when I write a draft, if I'm happy with that draft, I put it on my publication repository, I take the link to it and send that to a couple of colleagues, say, what do you think about it? And I integrate, I make new versions from the comments I receive, and at some point I say, maybe I could publish that. Send that to a journal or have that as a book chapter, what have you. So I've got a couple of papers, which have been, one in particular, which has been published on my publication repositories 2 years ago, which is highly quoted and it's still not published in this edited book that should appear maybe in 5 years, I don't know. Don't care. It's already read and cited. comply to external international standards. That's very important. I'm not giving names because it's really anonymous peer reviewing. I was reviewing a paper this morning from someone, no name, reinventing a complete XML format for representing text. Interesting. I mean, you need to read that once in your life. And consider online dissemination when you have a publication project. So anything which resembles like a publication project, I mentioned concerning publication, but that's true also for, yes, your PhD. I know it's a touchy issue in Germany. So for instance, if you go to a publisher, because you need to, you have to publish your PhD, otherwise you will never get a position. And he says, no, you're not allowed to put your PDF online. You change publisher. You go to another, we say, vous changez de crèmerie in French. Can someone translate that in?
You change.
You say that in English as well, yeah. Well,
makes sense.
Okay. But that's true for anything. So scholarly editions, your notes. I wish I had more time to actually blog, but I mean, the number of times where I collect a few ideas on a paper and I said, okay, those notes will be lost soon. I should probably blog and type in my ideas concerning this. That's very important. You know, when you go on a platform, I mean, we all use hypothèse.org, I guess, for blogging, I mean, most of us. I mean, you get a timestamp, you've got long-term archiving behind the thing. It's a real publication to do a blog entry on hypothèse. So it can be cited, you've got a persistent identifier associated to that. And you can get comments from the community. Someone would say, a couple of people saying, well, that's very cool what you're doing that. You should probably elaborate and write a paper out of that. So that's the process. And then, yes, be proud of being open. So it means anytime you detect that someone has reused your, even if he has not quoted you, you can mention, this has been reused by this scholar in this project. You've seen that. I mean, this data was mentioned, it's part of your CV. It's not just the publication list, it's the reuse list, which is important.